Hi, everybody. Thanks for joining us today in Black Creatives and Animation. My name is Stevi Carter, and I work in the Features Animation Production Team as a Manager of Development. I want to talk a little bit about why we're here today. I want this to be a moment of Black joy. The last few weeks, Black folks have been on the forefront of every conversation, whether that's been positive or negative. And I just really want to think about how we can appreciate all of my friends and family who've checked in and allies who've checked in, but I found myself seeking these side conversations with my Black friends, my Black colleagues, talking about our feelings in this current climate. And it felt like the right time to encourage and continue to build a Black community in animation and honestly have a real discussion about how we're doing and what's going on right now. I talked to Netflix about my idea and they've been nothing but supportive. So shout out to the Netflix people who helped put this all together. We had an overwhelmingly amount of positive responses from all of you. We've received over 700 questions. So while we're not going to get through all of them today, I believe this conversation is going to answer some great ones. Let's introduce our panelists. They are all amazing and they come from all different areas of animation. Tell us who you are, your background, and what you're all about. Brie, we'll start with you.
Hi, guys. Thanks for joining. My name is Brie Henderson. I'm from the Bronx, New York. I was born in Harlem. And I went to school in San Francisco, and now I live in Los Angeles as a color stylist for Netflix. Yeah. And I color my hair. I don't know if you can tell. I do that too. Thing.
That's what I thought you meant with color stylist.
Oh my God, yeah. The colors, can't you tell?
Awesome. Peter, what's up?
Hello, everybody. Peter Ramsey here. Los Angeles native, born and bred, one of the proud. I am a director in animation. I was at DreamWorks Animation for, 11 years, and I directed a couple of things there, including Rise of the Guardians. Before that, I was a live-action storyboard artist for many years, so I'm old. And after Rise of the Guardians, a couple of years ago, I directed, or co-directed, rather, along with my my buddies, Rodney Rothman and the great Bob Persichetti, Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse. So,
Big deal. No big deal.
No, you know, it's okay. But, so that's where that brings us up to today, and I'm happy to be here.
Great. Frank, tell us about yourself.
Hey, everybody. I'm seeing those comments like, brrr.
Yeah.
caught some names, though, so I'm grateful for everybody showing up. My name is Frank Abney. I'm a director, I'm from the Bay Area. Spent some years in games, a little bit of TV, jumped over to feature at Disney Animation. And then DreamWorks Animation, and just recently at Pixar, and now I'm off creating some cool stuff.
Amazing. Everett?
Hello, everybody. My name's Everett Downing. I, too, am an old dog. I've been in this business for a little while. I cut my teeth on the very first Ice Age, just like, you know, big up to Blue Sky Studios, but I've been all over the place, worked at Blue Sky, Pixar, DreamWorks, Sony, before I ended up landing at Netflix. Most recently, I directed the short Hair Love with Matthew Cherry. And I'm just happy to be here. Working on some cool stuff at Netflix too, so. That I can't talk about. Sorry, y'all.
I told you. I can already tell what it's going to be like. Tell us about yourself.
Okay. Hey, everybody. My name is Kerri Grant. I'm from Jamaica, born and raised till I was 11. Then moved to New York, where I grew up. And my first job in animation was on a show called The Backyardigans way back in the day.
Oh, yeah.
So I think I'm an old dog, too.
Yeah.
So yeah, that was my first job in animation way back in, 16, 17 years ago, something like that. And then about 12 years ago, I moved out to LA, did the writing program at Nickelodeon. And then got my first staff writing gig was on a small show called Doc McStuffins. ever since then, I've just been going, you know, staff writing on various shows. And now, including, of course, Doc McStuffins, Elena of Avalor, Nella the Princess Knight, among others. And now I'm co-EPing and story editing on a Netflix show that I can't talk about. happy to be here.
Y'all got secrets. All right, Jack, tell us about yourself.
Hey, last and very least is Jack Knight. How you guys doing?
I planned that. That was like
No, I'm from Seattle, Washington. I'm a writer and a stand-up comedian, and I write for the show Big Mouth on Netflix. I also play a character, Devon, on Netflix, and a couple of, you know, played characters here and there. I worked on Lucas Brothers Moving Company. I have a couple of animation projects I'm trying to, can't talk about because Stevi has a gun pointed behind all of our heads.
I know, I'm crazy.
We can talk about it.
Yeah, and you know, I'm just really excited to be here. I just want to apologize for my facial hair. I know I look like a Taekwondo coach, but just wanted to say that I'm happy to be here with a lot of very funny and talented people, and you know, dream come true shit.
I love it.
Thank you guys for following the rules. I told y'all some keep things quiet and y'all did. Let's just ground ourselves really quick. You know, talk about the reality we're in just to set the stage, and then we'll kind of really dig into it. So there's a pandemic going on, there's racial and systematic oppression, and we still got to go to work every day. So I just want to check in with you guys and how you've been holding up the last few weeks. That's been really hard for some, but how are you guys managing? Everett, how are you doing?
Oh man, it's been obviously very strange times, a lot of pressure. Like, you know, I'm working on an amazing show. I've got an amazing opportunity, but in the midst of it, you know, the whole George Floyd thing happened, and it really kind of shook me, and I still have to make deadlines, you know what I mean? And it was really hard for me to work for a while, but I kind of just took like solace in the fact, like, there's not, like, you know, the stuff I'm working on, there's nothing like this out there. This is going to like help this whole conversation. So that really motivated me. It really keeps me going. Actually, so, you know, it really fuels me. And then, you know, I've got two little girls and I'm looking at them and I'm like, I'm trying to make this world better for them. So it kind of like, for me, it's like, you know, we're kind of used to adversity, I think, as Black people. So it's like, oh, well, this is just the reality, and we just kind of got to keep forging forward. So,
yeah, absolutely. What about you, Jack? How are you feeling?
I finished the writer's room for Big Mouth and went to my mama's house. So I don't know what that means, but that's where I am emotionally. Yeah. I flew back home. I'm like, yeah, LA got too many fireworks that are given by the police. Yeah. So I'm gonna go ahead and go home.
Yeah, for real.
But mentally, I don't know, man. I'll be riding my bike. I'm cool.
Yeah. You know, I feel like as Black people, we're always separating ourselves. Like, there's the real world, the pain you deal with, and you kind of train yourself to go to work and just be in the everyday norm and act like nothing's happening. So I think this was the first time for a lot of people, for me at least, I started to bleed into both, right? I was bringing that pain to the office and it was hard to comprehend.
Yeah.
But, you know,
I think you're kind of forced to face it now because, you know, we have to work at home and you know, you don't have that same kind of escape that you had before. And so I know for me, it's been kind of like, focusing on the work has helped because, you know, you're focusing on putting something positive into the world and you know, hoping that it reaches to a level that it can create some kind of healing, you know, with what you're creating. But at the same time, it's good to take those moments to really sit with yourself and your feelings. And just, you know, I had a moment where I had a few minutes of just like clearing everything, and then, you know, I kind of broke down a little bit, and not a little bit, but a lot of it. And it was it felt good though, because then you're not holding that stuff in. You know, I think as artists, we're putting that stuff into our work anyway, but, you know, there's also the dealing with it on your own as well that I think is necessary.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And, you know, thinking about animation and how you can control and build the world you want to be in, you know, but you can't control that. But you can't control the outside world. So how are you guys as creatives, like, how does that how is this new world that we kind of been magnified in, how is that impacting you as creatives in animation? What about you, Brie? Has this changed anything for you?
Yeah, it's actually, it's done two things for me. It's made me a bit excited and a bit concerned, because I worry that everything that I create from here on out is going to be seen as a political statement, because I am a Black female in animation, and I'm a part of this massive historical change in animation where we want more, we want to see more, we're desperate for it, we're pretty tired of, you know, a lot of the tropes that we already have, and it's time for something new. And so for me personally, I'm working on a pitch, and the way that I have it is, like, with the stories, I'm concerned that it's going to be seen as an attack on our society, which it's not. It's something I've been developing for years, you know? It's got nothing, yeah. It literally has nothing to do with the present, but I know how people will see it and will critique it and judge it and won't see it for what it is at the heart of it. And that scares me. But on the other side, I feel like we're at this point in animation now where it's like, we want to see more main Black characters. We want to see more main female leads. Well, not even just Black leads, just everything. Give us more. We're thirsty for it, you know? And I think we're at that point where everyone recognizes that.
Yeah, absolutely. And the impact that we can have, you know, when I think about Black characters, we've hardly held on to human form through those movies, you know, we're animals, we're spirits, we're ghosts. And I think about Peter, did you think about that when you're making Into the Spider-Verse? Was that in your mind, the idea of this is a fully Black character who's staying human through the whole time on his journey?
Yeah, well, you know, when we first started, he actually was a spider for most of the movie. So I talked with them about that. And no, I'm just, come on. I'm just
everything.
Yeah. No, we didn't. No, we didn't.
Hey, you guys were like, oh, man.
I know.
I'm like, oh.
I know.
Cancel us.
It's in the news.
I'm like, I got to reread
today. You can't do that. It's terrible.
Sorry, that was good, Peter. I'm like, wow, Peter, dang.
You made a change.
I know. People are coming to burn down my house. Leave Sony Studios alone. Come on. Pull down the statue of Mr. Sony. No, you know, the interesting thing about Spider-Verse was that, you know, when Phil Lord and Chris Miller were first approached about doing an animated Spider-Man movie, it was just a Peter Parker movie. So they kind of said, thanks, but, you know, we've just seen a whole raft of Peter Parker movies, and it feels a little oversaturated right now. And then they thought about it, came back a few days later, and he said, you know, there's this Miles Morales version of the character. If we could make him the subject of the movie, now that would be something interesting. Mm-hmm. So, right, you know, and Sony, you know, smartly said yes. And so kind of from the jump, that idea of, okay, we're doing something different. You know, we're breaking a mold, and we're introducing something that hasn't been seen in this venue before. Yeah. And so right from the very beginning, that kind of put the whole project on a footing of, you know, how do we make this different and true to itself? And how do we make people buy into the idea of this new Spider-Man, which was, you know, a big change for the franchise. But in order to do that, you got to make people fall in love with and empathize with this main character the same way they do with Peter Parker. So a lot of thought went into, how do we bring Miles to life? How can we make him as, like, empathetic and believable as possible to an audience watching this movie right now? So many of our decisions were just really that was the center of it. You know, how do we connect people to this character the way he would actually be? And that just got us thinking deeper and deeper about, you know, where he lived and who his parents were and what kind of music he listened to, what his clothes were, what his hair was. Every single detail to literally bring him to life. And, you know, everybody was really invested in telling his story. And I think it wasn't like, you know, we knew it was going to have an impact, and it was like, oh, wow, Black Spider-Man. Oh man, Afro-Latino. Wow. That's a lot of people. It's an exciting thing. It's a new thing. The impetus was to present him as a fully fleshed out character on his own terms. You know, and to me, that's the heart of a lot of what all of us just want to do. We just want to tell real stories about real people who happen to be Black or, you know, Hispanic or Asian or whatever. But we want that same license to be able to display the full spectrum of everything with characters who come out of our experience or an experience like ours. Mm-hmm. And that, I think that was the heart of what was that of Spider-Verse.
No, and it was felt, you know, I think people really responded to that. Mm-hmm. And the impact that it has on its audience is so important. Kerri, I think about how you work in the preschool space and thinking about the very first representation of exposure to kids everywhere. Do you think about some of that representation while you're creating?
Oh, definitely. I've been lucky enough to work on almost all the shows that I've worked on have featured Black characters in some sort of lead role, starting with the Backyardigans. I mean, they weren't humans, but there was a character named Uniqua. There was a character named Tyrone.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So yeah. I feel like—
When you hear their voices, just, I was like, the Black kids.
Yeah.
That's a spider right there.
So I feel like my career just kind of started in that place. And then as I've moved forward, you know, like I said, coming out to LA, working on Doc, working on Nella the Princess Knight, working on, like, it just so happens that that's how my career has progressed, you know? And so, absolutely, I think about how we represent Black characters in the shows that I work on. And whether it's, I think, you know, when I was younger, of course, I was, more afraid to speak up. I was very quiet for a lot of years. And I'm not saying that I've made a complete trajectory out of that space, but it's something that I always think about, always carry with me, and always think really deeply about when thinking about who these characters are and how we write them, how they're represented, how multidimensional they are. Mm-hmm. Like, it's just something that, whether it's conscious or subconscious, that I infuse into everything, for sure.
Yeah. No, and then, you know, there's, because we have to think about these characters, because there's not enough representation out there of everybody, right? So when you do get that opportunity, you're like, how do I expand and really go deep? So, because these stories are universal, right? So it's really just...
Mm-hmm. And kids take everything in.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Yeah. You know, things you don't even realize that they're taking in, they're taking it.
Yeah.
So it's important.
If I may, I think that working in preschool is it's so beautiful, because you're one of the first people engaging with someone so young. Mm-hmm. They are sat in front of that TV or that computer, and they are taking in everything you have created. Mm-hmm. And so every word your character speaks, every action, every environment, every color, well, then they'll take that and they'll look at their own world and see how they correlate.
Right. You know, yeah, for sure.
What's better? You know, do they want to be in the world that's, you know, this amazing fantasy land, or are they safe and happy in their real world? And sometimes you end up growing up realizing that, oh man, what I saw on TV is better than what's out here. How can we make that change? Or, you know, you grow up and you don't see enough of what you want to see in TV or in film or in such, and then you're like, okay, time to make that change, because it starts real young. Honestly, yeah. Mm-hmm. What she starts really
for sure,
and it allows other kids to see other kids who don't look like them and follow their journey. So at a young age, you're already getting exposed to different groups of people you may not be able to grow up with.
Mm-hmm.
So that's powerful.
Yeah,
and thinking about how that translates with kids, and then translate that to adulthood. With Jack, you were in the adult animation space.
Yeah, pussy jokes.
That's all you care
Teach
about.
Nobody nothing.
Filthy no, animal.
There goes the
really taking in.
I know.
I'm really taking in everything Kerri and Brie was saying, because writing at Big Mouth, we just had a recent transition from our wonderful, wonderful actor, Jenny Slate, stepping down as the role of Missy. Oh, yeah. And, you know, white actors like on Simpsons or any of these other shows are playing Black actors, and, you know, the conversation of what that actually means. And
even for me, there was a piece of me that's like, this isn't the fight. I don't know if this is the thing that you're worried about. But then I saw this Netflix documentary Discourse, and they're explaining what it's like to watch as a cis man plays trans roles over and over and over again, not getting any opportunities to actual trans actors who are amazing. And so I think that same thing should apply to Black actors in animation and Asian actors in animation and all these things. Like, if these Black animation actors, we can't just give C every single job. Like, we got to make sure that these people are employed and work. And as great as Jenny Slate is, and she actually was a person to come forward to us and say, "This is, I would like to step down and give this role to someone," because of how much work we do in the season coming up with Missy and with Blackness. It was a little uncomfortable for her, and she'd made the right decision. And we really, really explored Blackness in the upcoming seasons of Big Mouth. So I'm very proud of Jenny for what she did. I'm proud of where I work. And
no, I think that's great. And it's really an honest moment of how allies can show up too. Like Jenny stepping up, Kristen Bell stepping up, saying, "Hey, there's other opportunities out here," and using their power. How do you guys feel about using your power in the day-to-day? Like, do you feel like there's opportunities where you can make change and the things you're talking about and what you want to see? Some of you are already doing it, but can you just talk a little bit about your process in that? Maybe we'll start with you, Everett.
Yeah, I'm a full believer in it. I mean, just as somebody who kind of came from a space, like when I was really in CG animation, like the studios that I was at, I was like the only Black guy in creative. And it, like, I just remember how kind of like, it felt like an island. A lot of times, you know, like when you're in a competitive environment, you know, you just always got to kind of be your best, show your best. So now that I'm in this position, where I feel I can be more of a mentor, I'm relishing it. Like I'm like, okay, you know, like I've seen this. I actually don't want anybody to have to go through what I went through, in the industry. Like it's, you know, I had a lot of success, you know, it was really great, but I actually had a lot of really rough things kind of happen to me. And I had, you know, I don't want anybody to have to suffer in silence. So, you know, any opportunity I get, it's like, I'm going to have the tough conversations. Like if I show a portfolio to, you know, and I'm like, I want this person on my team. Like, well, you know, I don't know, this person is not the strongest yet. No, like, no, this person like has a lot of talent, a lot of potential. Like, it's kind of our duty to train this person up. We got to like, we got to knight this person, you know? And kind of like, it was really funny, you know, to go back to kind of the George Floyd moment. I just remember being a little incensed and kind of like not caring kind of what people think. Cause you know, at a certain point it's like enough, you know what I mean? It's like, I'm in this position. I have power to change things. And I kind of don't care how uncomfortable you are, because I think a lot of times we've sort of spent a lot of our energy trying to make ourselves, especially me, you know, like in my career, trying to make myself approachable and like that, you know, nice. And like, you know, I don't want to say anything that's going to make anyone mad. And you're trying to like, I don't want to make anybody uncomfortable. Oh, I'm standing in an elevator and this person is getting nervous. I'm just going to step to the side. It's like, no, like that's not my problem. That's your problem. And I just feel like now I'm in a position like, nope, come on, guys. I'm like holding the door open. Come on in here. Let's get you in here. Let's get you a seat at the table. So that's kind of where I'm at.
No, I think that's incredible. Yes. And it's amazing because it kind of showcases why we need diversity in different levels of animation, right? It can't just be entry level. It's got to be from the top to the middle to the bottom. Yeah. Everybody has to be a part of it, right? And it's not just on the diverse people. It's on everybody to really care about that.
Yeah, I think it also you gotta give you know, as a studio or you know an entity where people work. I mean, you gotta give people that space to be able to have a voice, because if you're gonna spend your time somewhere most of the day away from your family, you deserve to be happy being there.
Absolutely.
Yes.
You know, you're not gonna go somewhere to be miserable for 8 to 10 hours a day and then, you know, just because you're getting paid to be there, like, we all have to do what we have to do. But, you know, if any of these companies care about the quality of work that they get, then I think they should also care about you being happy, because then if you're taking care of yourself and you're happy, you're going to deliver the best stuff that you can, that you can do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
100%.
Yeah. You have to bring your best selves in. And sometimes as a person of color and these, you know, and the industry, it's not always easy, right? You're coming in and you walk into a space and you realize you might be the only one, you know. Yeah. I kind of describe, like, the industry is shifting a lot, but I remember when I first started, it reminded me of a party. This is right at the top of my head. A party, you're like, I don't know, I'm going with this. You come into this party, you're waiting in line, you get in and you don't know anybody and they're all talking to each other. They're all having a good time. And this is the party of the century, but you don't feel comfortable. You don't feel like you're in that space. And it's that makes me think, like, oh, we have to get more people in this party. I want to call my friends. I'm texting all of you guys, like, get to this party. It's dope.
Right.
I'm still here. But, like,
if I can bite off of what all three of you said, I'm very loud and outspoken about this, but I collect a lot of art of books. It's a massive obsession of mine. But I'm so sick and tired of seeing the same exact names in every single art book that I collect. I'm so desperate to see new people in the industry, not the same. Yes, obviously, exceptionally talented artists carried on through every film, through every show. Sure, great, you're talented, you're amazing. But this industry needs to stop being so afraid of hiring straight out of college. Mm. There's nothing wrong with green artists, nothing wrong with people who haven't had an opportunity to show that they can shine yet. Because when you start taking away from people who have spent $60,000, $80,000, $100,000 in university just to be damn good at what you're damn good at, and you're not giving them that opportunity, it's a waste of their money, it's a waste of their time, their parents' money, and it hurts them. You know, as artists, we are so sensitive. You know, men, women, everything in between. We are very hypersensitive people and we get hurt a lot, you know, rejections and people putting out an olive branch and saying, oh, snap, I want you on this gig, you know, like, you're fresh out of university, you know, the world's hitting you hard. And you've got people who are like, we want you on this thing and you're great. And then they just totally ditch you, abandon you, nothing. That has happened to me, and that's not okay. And I know that happens to everyone else. Why is that okay? Like, why is that a practice that is fine? That sort of thing, like, terrified me and almost broke me. Like, I was so close to not being in the industry because of so many similar happenings wherein, like, people would promise me things, which, you know, I was gullible, sure. But don't make promises you can't keep, which, Stevi, I love you for you making promises that you keep. That is a, you have, oh my gosh. But I'm venting. I don't want to vent. But,
Bring it.
Yeah. It's only us seven people. No one's here.
I will speak names.
Tough out of school too, because when you get out of school, you can get caught in that loop of, like, you're trying to get somewhere, but everyone wants you to have experience, and you're like, okay, well, if everyone wants me to have experience, how can I get experience?
Right.
And so, you know, there needs to be that change of, like you said, like, looking at the if they're good, they're good. Like, look at the person, invest in the person, not what's on paper.
Just to speak on that really quickly, Frank, it's funny because, like, something I didn't realize until recently when I really, like, had to analyze my journey in this industry, I pretty much lied to get in. Like, I lied because, like, do you have experience? Yes, I do. You know how to animate CG? Yes, I do. Mm-hmm. So I'm going in. I had really great, amazing friends in college who taught me how to use CG. We did a short together. They're spending their time. We're spending, like, late nights and hours on this stuff. And then I'm going, I'm like, yeah, I've got experience, because otherwise I had to create my opportunities, because no one was going to give them to me. And I remember going into jobs being like, yeah, so this is great. Here's the character that you have to animate. I'm seeing, like, this character, like, light up like a Christmas tree with this control, like, and I'm freaking out. And they're like, yeah, so you can do a walk cycle, right? I'm like, yeah, no problem. There with, like, you know, Maya essentials, you know, like, oh snap, like, you know.
No.
But I mean, that also kind of speaks to kind of, like, the lengths that we have to go to. It's like, because you can't, like, we always kind of have to be the strong candidate, because it's always like, well, is this guy good enough? So you can't show weakness. And then there's no allies, because it's so competitive. you know, especially right. at that time. The industry's so competitive. It's like, dude, you just don't know. You just don't know how to animate. You just don't know how to storyboard. Like, that's just, sorry, that's your problem. That's not. And like, I'm searching for brown faces anytime I go anywhere, and like, I'm not finding them. So it's like a lot of my like Latino and Asian brothers out there help me out. I was like, I'm finding you guys, and I'm like, help me out. And, I mean, that's part of the reason I was able to even hang around in this industry, you know?
It's, you know, it's tough because the industry as a whole, it's run on fear and insecurity. And I'm talking about the people at the top, you know, the people at the people doing, making the hiring decisions and watching the, doing the gatekeeping.
They want to
play it safe. They just want the machine to hum along with no bumps, and they don't want to have to worry about individual artists or personalities or who's sensitive and who's not, or who needs to be trained. They want boom, 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 consistency and results. So in that sense, you know, looking at what we as creative people and artists, people of color, people, period, are up against, you know, that's really, it's really tough. And it's been that way for a long time. And it's, you know, how to change that cultural mindset of fear and like the reluctance to give people space to, you know, fall or fail or whatever. That's like a key point that's got to be addressed, because just the idea of for you know, studios to be able to keep making good things, you need new fresh people. You know, the cycle has to keep going. So people have to be made to understand it's in their own self-interest to foster a culture that's more more nurturing of that. You know, and they don't want to hear any of that shit. They don't. No. You know, it's they don't want to have to take care of anyone, but they're slitting their own throats if they don't.
I just piggyback on what Peter's saying. I think some of that responsibility falls on us for, like, I didn't know any of your jobs existed. I didn't know most of the storyboard jobs existed. Directing, like, in my head as a kid loving animation, all I thought was some cool people went in the booth and made it all up.
Same here.
Exactly. I think it comes down to, as many times as we want to point the finger at the white man, how to
move. Right.
Yeah.
But there is a job, and for us to go around and educate our own people about that. There's numerous jobs in this industry that they can take, and it's not just being a voice actor, and it's not just making the final touches on coloring. And show them that there's a whole life that they can have just working on the 7 to 8 levels that it takes to make the cartoon that they love.
Right. That is 100%. When I first walked in to, I had an internship at Nickelodeon before I got my job in Backyardigans, and it was like an accidental internship. I had an advertising class. I mean, I had this advertising class in college, and we won this national student competition, and everyone got internships at ad agencies. Huh. And by the time that class was over, I knew I did not want to do advertising. But there was one internship at Nickelodeon, and I was like, me, right? So, but I walked in and I was like, oh my God, I always knew I wanted to be a writer, you know, even though I majored in business as an undergrad, because I thought that that was what I was supposed to do, you know, especially as an immigrant. I was like, I have to do business or law or fine or something stable. And then I would go back to my room and write, you know, every night. And it was just something that I did. It was just a part of me. It never occurred to me that I could do this for a living. But when I walked into that, to Nickelodeon, when I got that internship, like, it opened up this world that I had no idea even existed, even though, of course, we grew up watching those shows. But it didn't occur to me that that somebody was there writing the shows and making it. And so I walk into this really colorful office where people are young and everyone has TVs on, and you wear jeans to work. And I was like, for a career, where I wear a suit and pantyhose, you know? And so, like, I just took whatever job came available, which at the time was in viewer services, answering phone calls and fan mail. So people would write to the Rugrats or whatever, and I'd respond.
Like, I love that.
Like, oh, they can't write yet. So, you know, they asked me to respond for them or whatever. And then I weaseled my way into a job that I didn't know how to do on the Backyardigans. And so the learning curve was so steep for me. And every day I thought I was going to get fired.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. That's real.
So and then now, you know, fast forward however many years later, I find that, like, the mentoring part of the job, oh my God, I love it so much. Mm-hmm. I was like, wow. And it's like something that I've grown into and have had to grow into. So to piggyback on your point, Jack, yeah, it is incumbent on us to seek people and to really like search people out to help along. Mm-hmm. So I think for so long too, I mean, let me speak for myself. It's like, I'm just like holding my corner, you know, just got used to being like one of the only or a few Black people in the room. And I'm just like holding my corner and holding my job. Right. But, and then there's like a fear that seeps in, like a fear of making waves, a fear of speaking too much, a fear, you know, it's like so many balancing acts that I felt like I had to do, whether self-imposed or not. But some self-imposed, some externally imposed, whatever. I feel like, especially now, like now is a ripe time for us to really step out of our comfort zones and like be brave.
Yeah,
braver.
Absolutely agree with you.
I'm sorry for jumping in, because I just wanted to like piggyback what she's saying, because it's so right. But I think it comes down to like, they get to pick which Black ideas they like, which in itself is racist as fuck. And so that is tokenization in itself. Yeah. And so I don't, every Black person, that, like I only got picked to be on Big Mouth because Nick Kroll saw me be funny somewhere. Wow. And it's like that, we have to be able to break that mold ourselves. Like, I want to see every color of Black makes, I want to see a hood nigga's midnight gospel. Can't always like say that this cookie cutter Black can do this and this queer Black can do that. Mm-hmm. I think we need to allow every color of Black to come in and do whatever the hell they want, because that in itself is creativity, not just picking this one tone.
Right. And Kerri, if I may, I think it also comes down to being on a production, and this is, of course, if you're, you know, if you're employed, but being on a production that allows, that's an open door to a myriad of questions. If you want to know about what your production coordinator does, you know, if you want to know about what your lead character designer does, or storyboard artist does, or even just like a revisionist, or any position, all the way up from the top of creator to executive, and all the way to my position, which is one of the last positions as a color stylist, there needs to be an open door where everyone can ask, hey, how do you do your job? How is it that you got there so that I may not be, you know, I may not want to do that job, but I'm so stinking interested in it, and I want to know how you did it, because it will inform me, and it will also allow me to work easier with you, you know, as someone who, you know, your position comes before mine, so like we need to work together, or my position comes before someone else, so we need to work together, you know? So it's like, there needs to be an open door. There can't be, like, within a solid team, there can't be secrets, there can't be, like, pettiness, there can't be toxicity, and... Yeah. This industry is made up of so many toxic teams. And I hate to say that. Know who you are. You're toxic as fuck, and you need to stop. All
that right? Was loaded.
Animation, so many people animation end up hiring who they know. It's kind of the comfort zone of, I work with this person, I work with that person.
Yeah.
So the door's never really swiveling. It's just kind of the same people switching spots, and if somebody gets lucky and they get in, you know, that's where we start to cultivate new voices and new people. But that takes time, right? And that doesn't have to be the way, you know? And I think it's just everybody, you know, from the top, especially, like, figuring out how do we take chances on people? How do we not just get them in the door and like, cool, we hired two Black people, we're good. You have to empower. You have to keep people moving and working and feeling like they can keep growing. And I think that that's something that this industry is still working on, you know? Like, I think the conversations are happening, but now we need to see the action be long-term. This is an investment, you know?
Putting the work behind the intent and the action, and not just the checkoff box. I mean, same thing with like content, with film ideas, with, you know, you have a movie where, you know, they throw just, you know, a Black person in there just to add, okay, we checked off diversity for this project. And it's like, no, you throw a character of any ethnicity into a project, like put the work in to expand on their experience, you know, what they're bringing to the table, and not just a character that you can just easily swap out, you know, skin textures or whatever, like put some specificity in there and speak to speak to the experience and actually, you know, if you care about the audience enough and not just what they're contributing to your business or whatever, you know, mm-hmm. it's ultimately about connecting. So I think that's pretty much all what we're in here for is wanting to connect with people. Yeah. And so, you know, you put that extra something into those characters, you know, you're going to be touching, you know, X amount of people. And then you're just going to add more to the industry because someone else is going to see that character and see themselves and want to do it. And then everything, it's like, paint it forward.
Beautifully said.
Yeah. There's some language I would love to kind of take out of some of this conversation that I don't even know if people are aware. Like this whole, like just the term, like, oh, we got to give them, you know, freedom to fail. Like just that from the beginning is like, you're starting out from negative. Can we give them the freedom to flourish? Like that would be great. Like give that person like the time to actually like learn and support them so they can actually grow. Yeah. I'd also love to kind of take out the idea of like, oh, just so you know, like we're taking, this is one of the projects we can take a risk on talent. Like why is if you're hiring talent, why is it a risk?
Is it a risk?
Like, right. It's a gift, right?
Yeah. Yes, so yes. it's just, you know, and also that puts a burden on us. It's like, okay, so like I'm the black dude that's gotta, you know, I gotta like make something real good or like we don't get to do it again for who knows how long.
As if you didn't do enough proving
just to get to the spot, you know.
And then you got to redo the proving to prove that they made a choice.
Every time.
That's right for them.
Every time.
And I've seen people in this industry who do get to fail every time, multiple times, and no one talks about it, right? I see chances keep giving it, but then when somebody of color fails, it feels like the pressure's on, like, oh, we tried, you know, we gave people a chance, it's too hard, and it's not, because I see it happen all the time, so it's like, how can we, you're right, like, take that language away.
Yeah.
I would love to openly shit on black creators, but I can't, because everybody else is not enough. You're hating.
Yeah,
I know what you mean. Yeah.
You want the freedom to shit. That's the greatest gift of white privilege is shitting on their peers.
Yeah, we cannot. We all gotta rise up, no matter how. Right?
No, that was good, bro. That was good.
Also, Frank, if I may, I think people should not be afraid to do a little bit of research. You know, if they want to. Yeah. If hypothetically you're Caucasian or mixed or anything, whatever, I don't care, black, brown, bronze, whatever. And if you want to do a story or create a character that's way beyond your comfort zone or way beyond your knowledge or your race or your demographic or whatever, do a bit of research, ask around, you know, ask a friend of a friend who may know a friend who's a friend of a cousin, you know, who is what you're looking for, because that's always a thing. But, you know, we have Google at our hands, or Bing. Some people still use Bing. I like Bing.
That's fine. Forget it. I was like, this is not a paid advertisement.
I'm so sorry.
No, I'm just kidding.
Oh, yeah. Thank you, Gatorade.
All right. Do we have to edit this out?
Do some research. Do a lot of research, you know, and get to the nitty gritty of that culture that you want to make either, you know, a fantasy story about, or a more believable story based on someone who's existing. No one is saying don't make these stories. Fuck, I want to see more of these stories. I would die to see more Polynesian, Samoan, Native Hawaiian stories. That's I would love that. I would see that. Would die to see some like beautiful Edo period Disney film that's not in a Disney style. I need more. I'm so desperate for so many things, and I feel like, why do I have to ask? Why is it so hard for someone to just say yes? It's so easy to say yes to something new and beautiful. Sure, it's a little bit of money. You don't have to order from whatever restaurant for a day or two. It pays for itself in the end, because then you start getting in new people who want to love and live in and be a part of animation. And then you start pulling people back in who have lost faith in animation, because I know those people who no longer like animation because it's drab and sad. Not everything, obviously, but the majority makes everything dried and sad, you know? So
I can't tell you how many artists that I feel like there's a few that I kind of, I don't want to say save, but like there are a few people I talked out of like, nope, don't do it. Like stay in here, man. Like stay in here. Like, you know, we need your voices in this industry. You can't bail. I'm proud to say, you know, I've got a relative who's, you know, was about to bail out the industry. And I'm like, you can't, like, you know, and I get it, you know, just to kind of, you know, to relate something, give you guys kind of an idea. It's like, you know, for years, you know, I'm just now getting to do something really amazing. You know, it's like I'm 48, you know, I'm an old dog, right? So like, I've been offered, people have suggested me for directing roles since I was 26, 27. Wow. But the whole time, everyone's always said, this guy's green, he doesn't have any experience. Yeah. I'm literally like rising up in my career, not that far, and they're, my peers are going like, I'm surprised you don't have X role. I'm surprised you haven't been offered this role. And this went on for a long time. So like now when I'm actually doing something, I kind of feel like, where did you come from? You kind of came out of nowhere, you know?
You've been here the whole time.
Yeah. You know, I had a colleague recently tell me, a really good friend of mine, he told me, he said, he was talking to an executive who asked him, hey, do you know any black directors? He brought me and a few other friends up and they're like, no, but they don't, they're not experienced. Like I need directors who directed before.
And that's the cycle we'll never get out of.
I hate that. That makes me so mad.
Where do you think all these directors start directing?
Like, no one's born a director.
Right. And you know, for me, even us putting together this panel, just talking about, I texted some of you guys are my friends, I made some new friends, but I was looking at a hole and I realized creators and showrunners that I couldn't find black female, a lot of black female creators, showrunners and directors. And that really hurt, you know? I was just like, wait a minute, I want to see all types of black people, all genders, all sexual orientation, all different experiences and it represented, right? Like everybody has a voice and we're all different. Truth be told, we all have different experiences. We all have different things we want to see. So I'm just thinking about how we've been transitioning, not just the kind of stories we've been telling. So when I think about when I was growing up, black movies were a lot about our oppression, right? And slavery and teaching, actually truthfully teaching the audience like, oh, these terrible things happen. So I started to identify a lot of those major best picture films being like really a tool. Then it started to transition into now we're really in a space where, you know, then we had the family sitcoms we all grew up watching that you all know that were written by mostly white people. And now we're in a new space where we're actually having an opportunity to tell authentic stories. And I don't think we're hungry. I think people are hungry. Like,
absolutely.
They just want
absolutely.
Because emotions are universal. You know, it's we're all just human. So it doesn't feel that hard. It's just, it feels like it's just a different flavor. It's exciting. I want to watch all cultures, you know, I want to go deep into different places, different regions globally. So thinking about what you guys want to see, what are things that you're hoping to see, at least in animation for yourselves, or if you're not seeing it yet, what do you think is next for us as an industry?
My ideas.
I completely agree. Take what I got. I got
we have a writer's room right here. We got a little production company.
I'll color everything.
the real honest answer is I want more for like young black girls who aren't like, who are dorky, and like I love Missy so much because there's so many members of my family that have related to Missy than anybody else. Like, I want to get as weird of black girls as possible on TV. The weirdest motherfuckers, like the booger eating motherfuckers. I want all this.
Yeah.
I mean, for me, just like, you know, my whole life growing up, you know, just not having, not ever seeing anybody who represented, like, you know, I mean, I knew what was inside me growing up, and never seeing that on the screen ever is like, wow, that's what is with this world? You know, I never see a you know, comic book fan, you know, bookwormy kid like me dream, you know, crazy daydreams and whatever else represented on the screen. But it's so, and it's funny, while I was working on Spider-Verse, just to drop that in again,
pulls out his
drop it as many times as you want. Time?
What did
drop
you
it
do?
As many times you want.
Who are you?
we're gonna write that one.
Sometimes, you know, I'd be sitting in a digital review and we'd be critiquing shots and stuff like that. Mm. And I'd look at some of these shots of Miles, like when he's sneaking around the collider and he's hiding. Yeah. And I'd see, I remember one particular day, there was one shot and I looked at it and I was like, suddenly I felt like I was a 12-year-old kid, because I was like, man, how many movies have I seen about little white boys having adventures and like having to hide from the bad guy? Yeah. Yeah. And you know, this is a pivotal moment and they have to step up and be a hero. And,
yeah.
And I just like, wow, it's like you get a little hit of a vitamin that you never got all your life, you know,
wow.
And you feel it and you go, man, this is really what this means, isn't it? Cause I still feel it. Beautiful. And I'm like, that was decades and decades. It's truly wild. So that's the thing that I want to see more of. I mean, is just getting inside the experience and the I guess the deep experience, the breadth of it, of any black person, you know, of like what that feels like. I mean, today, how that ties to this moment with, you know, George Floyd and Breonna Taylor, we all know the list. But just how our perceptions of just everyday life in this world at this moment are so different from like the mainstream of white experience.
Yeah.
You have a whole, there's a psychological, I don't want to say a chasm or a gulf, because I think we can, you know, there's always a way to bridge that stuff. Yeah. But just the way that we deal with and internalize the world is so different. You know, and I want people to understand that. I want people I want that to be able to be expressed in a way that creates greater understanding in the world. You know what I mean? Not just to like, you know, complain or, you know, cry or any of that stuff. I just want clarity and understanding. That's what we really, really need.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think same thing. Like, I don't think there's any particular like type of projects or something that I want to see out there, but I feel like, yeah, like pulling, like I want to see more people's history and stories being put into films. Cause I talk to some people sometimes and you know, they may be struggling with a story or they're trying to work out an idea or something like that. And, you know, and there may be experiences that I've heard from of theirs. And I'm like use that, like pull that out, like, you know, you I say this all the time when people ask like what you know, how can I stand out, like how can I stand out when I'm applying to all these places or whatever, and it's like putting yourself out there, because you know, we all have our unique paths and our unique perspectives, and ultimately I think that's what people want to see, and that's what, you know, because you know, we're all different, but at the same time very much the same, and that's what I want to see. I want to see people's heart.
That always translates no matter who you are, because it's true, it is universal. It doesn't, you know, my blackest experience, whatever that is gonna, if I'm true and honest about it, because it's true to my humanity, it's going to resonate with the widest possible person that you can imagine.
Mm-hmm.
It's, you know, it's just, we've just been taught that that's not the case, and we have to tear down that lie.
Yeah. Right.
There's people in my career who've told me, you know, especially with all the diversity talk happening, like, you can get this job because you're black. Like, they've always said that as if it was the only thing I had to offer. Right. And it used to be something that would just hit me the wrong way. I was like, well, also, I work my butt off. I'm smart. I do a lot of work. But then I realized that, no, that part of who I am is absolutely valuable to anybody, right? Like, everybody's experience adds to the table of all work, right? You just have to really come in with your own perspective.
Right. And, you know, I think that it's also, it's never wrong to write someone else's perspective either. I think it just depends on the amount of passion and understanding and respect you put into it too.
Yeah,
like absolutely. For me, what I want to see, it's fine if we don't get for me at least, this is just me, it's fine if I don't get a lead black character, that's fine. But what I want to see is characters that I can relate to in terms of personality or in terms of like what they like or what they do, you know, I have a lot of friends from all over the world, right? And so mm-hmm. I personally, the school that I went to was like 85% international students. And so a lot of my friends really are from mm-hmm. all walks of life. I want to see a show that really encompasses that. That's what I'm working on, right? Like my main group of friends, they're all so vastly different, but no one gives a shit, you know?
Mm-hmm.
It's at the core, you're great people that's together and it works and you love each other. And we don't see that enough. Usually we just get a group of white kids with like that one black kid or one black lead.
Right.
The fucking yeah. nerd who wears big round glasses. I mean, I wear big round glasses and I am a nerd. Yes.
Complaining about.
I get that. That's fine. But you know, it's a trope at this point, and I want to see more than the tropes that we're comfortable with, you know?
Yeah.
We want to see the world we want, right?
Yeah.
The world we actually live in.
Everybody should be moving to.
The world we actually live in.
The world we actually live in, the people we actually know.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Is, like true multifacetedness
characters,
because we're all multifaceted. We can like things that are totally contradictory to each other, and we tend mm-hmm. to kind of put people mm-hmm. in boxes. And I think mm-hmm. that's what I want to see, is characters not in boxes and liking things that seem contradictory and make sense, but make sense to that character and in the heart and soul and core of who that character is, because that's true.
Yep. Reality. You know?
So mm-hmm. yeah, that's what I want to see.
Yeah. I love it.
And some Caribbeans.
Yes,
with real Jamaican
chicken. I want to see them make some real good food, animated good food. Like you see, like Japanese animations that have beautiful, like Japanese animated food. I want to see beautiful Caribbean or West Indian animated food.
Hear me out. Hear me out. Hear me out.
All right. All right.
Okay. It's about to get wild.
The Haitian Revolution, the musical.
So all the history out. Well, that was nice. We're gonna go through all the pitches. Honestly, we're gonna go ahead and just do some more questions in the Q&A. We have a lot of questions to go through, so I just kind of want to get a few in there. So we're all in the industry right now, but I just want to quickly see if we want to give advice to those listening in who want to be in the room talking with us right now. What information or what inspiration can you give those who are watching, who are trying to get in the door, but they don't feel it's an easy path for them right now either?
Well, don't give up.
Yes.
Don't give up. Keep trying. Okay. I mean, I would say, you know, there are a lot of things that need to change once you're inside the industry, and there's, you know, hurdles as there are in every profession, and there's like, you know, there's resistance to change and all that stuff. Mm-hmm. I would say though, you know, this is life, you know, this is the real world. So don't, a thick skin is valuable no matter what you're going to do, whether in work or in life or dealing with anyone. So learn that like a setback or a slight or a negative vibe or whatever it is, that's not the end of your road. Push past that. You know, you can be stronger. This is part of your early working experience, is part of your maturing and your growth into being an adult. And part of that is, hey, learn how to take care of yourself, you know, learn how to separate something that doesn't actually hurt you as a person from something that, that does, you know. I mean, sometimes you're just dealing with other people's thoughts and perceptions. If those aren't going to materially hold you back, blow past them, man. Just keep going. Don't let other people's vision of you or perceived limitations of you hold you back, is I guess what I'm trying to say. And that just entails some you being able to go, you know what? Too bad, I'm doing it anyway. And I promise you, the longer you beat your head against that door, you're gonna your head might hurt a little bit, but somebody's gonna hear you beating against the door and they're gonna say, hey, what is that? Oh, what are you doing? Hey, that's pretty good. You've been at this a little bit, let me see. Yeah. Happened to me in my career, and I'm sure it happened to you guys over and over and over again. Yeah. Somebody's gonna open that door for you a little crack and they're gonna show you something or teach you something or give you the time of day, whatever it is. Usually a creative person, you know, the money people, that's another thing. creative people tend to reach back and help other creative people. Had that
100%.
From, you know, all races of all kinds, you know.
Yeah.
So stick to it. Really give it your best. Be sincere and just fight, man. You got to fight sometimes.
Yeah.
And just hold on. I'm
okay, Dad.
I've been in the same.
I'm probably Peter, adopt me.
I'm straight up dad.
Can Peter just adopt us all?
Yes, please.
I needed that speech.
Seriously.
Now I still need to speak.
I know it sounds dad, but I wouldn't be telling you this if I hadn't benefited from it in my own life. I'm
absolutely right.
You can consider me living proof. Yeah. Hang on. Mm-hmm. Beat your head.
Yeah. I would say there's power in declaring it. Like, if you haven't already, like, truly declare it for yourself.
Yeah.
Claim it for yourself. I remember I was sitting on before I got my job on the Backyard again, I was sitting on a bench in Union Square, New York, and I remember when I made the decision for myself that that's what I wanted to pursue. And then literally 2 or 3 weeks later, and an opportunity came for me, you know? Right. And, and I think also just remember that there are multiple ways. There are multiple paths.
Oh yeah.
So I think all of us here probably took multiple paths to get into the industry, which to me means that you don't know where your opportunity is going to come from.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So if you're banging 100%. Your head against one wall or one door,
right.
it's not happening, doesn't mean it's the end. Like, there are other doors, there are other ways, and just pay attention, look around. And somebody told me once, luck is when opportunity meets preparation, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Am I butchering that? Yeah. Mm. Luck is where opportunity meets preparation. So I take that to heart. And I think declaring it has a lot of power, and just remembering that there are a lot of doors.
Right. Yeah. Hey, Everett, do you remember how we met?
I do.
Right?
I do.
I owe a lot to you, to be quite fair, and just that you allowed me to flourish on just, I was able to paint some stuff with your direction and your guidance, and also with your just allowing me the freedom to grow on my own and, you know, take references that we both enjoyed and learn from them and whatnot. But I thank you for, like, allowing me to be a better artist for the time that we worked together. And it really is so funny how we met. I was complaining to one of my dearest friends, and then he hit you up. He was like, hey, you got work. I don't want to hear this anymore.
But, so complaining works too. Is what
complaining works.
That's right.
Well, I mean, with you, Brie, it was like, I mean, this stuff happens all the time.
Yeah.
It was a no-brainer. Like, I saw you work, and I'm like, literally in my head, I'm like, how is this person not working right now?
Yeah.
You know, I'm just a person that, like, I treat, like, all talent as a gift. Like, if someone comes and they want to work on anything that I want to work on, that's a gift to me. So I'm like, yes, please help me out. And you just, like, your perspective and your vibrance, like, it was like, it's a no-brainer. It's a no-brainer, you know? So.
Say more! Oh,
it's going to be the Brie section. Let's just talk about the Brie.
Love it! No!
But yeah, I will also say, just to kind of note, just in general, like, you know, to Black creators or any POC, like, let's skill up, you know? It's like, this is a moment, this is an opportunity, but y'all, we still got to skill up. So it's like, do your research, get out there, like, find out, like, you're interested in animation, just Google it, find out what the jobs are, you know, because there's a lot of opportunity for us right now,
that's
like, we got to come to the game with, you know, our game faces on. It's like,
gotta
it's
be
time
ready.
To, yeah.
And this kind of brings me to a question that's happening in the chat. Is there any specific books or courses, maybe that are, even courses or things that are less expensive for those who don't have access to art school or writing program? Do you guys have any recommendations of things people can use?
Me, I think I have an answer. So couple things, actually. I would just like to say really quickly, one of my very dear, very new friends and this is not to toot our own horn, but it's just to show the possibilities, you know, if you're in the right place in the right time, we're both sponsoring artists for an amazing program, right? And so sometimes it really is just all about seeing a Twitter post like, hey, I want to sponsor mm-hmm. some artists, or hey, I want to mentor some artists. Anyone interested? Send me your portfolio. Send me your, you know, a little bit about you. You might just get picked it. Picked it?
Hmm. You get what you're saying. We get what you're saying.
Yeah, yeah.
Black creatives.
Right? Yeah, you might just get chosen to meet like people like myself or people like you or other wonderful artists. And sometimes it doesn't have to cost anything at all. Mm-hmm. You know, sometimes it just takes people like us just putting it out there like, hey, I'm in the mood to mentor maybe like 5 people for a certain amount of weeks, and they could get so much more out of mm-hmm. out of just that
yeah.
small interaction than they could in a class of like maybe 15 or 16 others. Not saying that that's wrong, that's amazing as well, but there's so many, because not everyone has money. That's the thing.
True.
Yeah.
You know, the things, I feel like a lot of things that we could say that students could do to be better is kind of elitist and kind of gross, just because, like myself, I came from, I'm from the Bronx, right? The Bronx is crazy. You don't have a lot of money, and that's fine. But that just means you have to look for other resources. And sometimes that is looking for artists and animators and producers who are willing to give a bit of themselves and not mind not being paid and just wanting to help, wanting to see the next generation of artists grow. It's not that fucking hard. I'm sorry, but it makes me so angry that it genuinely took like just this whole uprising that we've had in the past couple of weeks for people. I'm pissed off at myself too, for people like myself and other artists, both POC, by POC and non, to just be like, hey, come on, all you Black artists, who wants to do some work? Oh, we've got more storyboarding gigs. It shouldn't be like that. I mean, it's fine, but it shouldn't have taken this long.
You know? Yeah, no, I totally agree. I've carried No, but we talk about like the artist path and how you can work. I'm curious too, because we have a lot of writers listening as well.
Yeah.
And you guys are representing that space really. Mm. So can you talk about any paths that you guys can speak to?
You want to go first, Kerri? Or?
Sure, yeah. I mean, like I said, I kind of got an internship just in general at Nickelodeon in programming, and then finagled that into a job in viewer services. And then through that, got a job as a script coordinator on the Backyardigans because a friend of mine worked at Nick Jr. at the time and knew that they were looking to staff up the show and knew that I wanted to be a writer. So recommended me for the job, like put my resume in. And then, so that's how I personally got in to the business. So, and then from there, just constantly fighting self-doubt and taking classes. You know, I know we just talked about maybe like taking classes is not a path for a lot of people. I was just so, it just so happened that at the time at Nickelodeon, they had this tuition reimbursement program.
Oh.
And I basically just took a class every semester because I didn't study writing formally, you know, in school. So it was just always like reading, taking classes. For the entire first year that I was on the Backyardigans, I was just stone cold quiet, just observing, taking notes. I mean, I was also super shy, but also just quiet, taking notes. That was like my grad school, you know, for writing.
You're doing the work.
Yeah, like reading scripts, formatting scripts, like learning that whole process through being there and doing it. So I would say if you have the opportunity to do an internship somewhere, you know, that's always a great path. That's always a great way. And then how I ended up getting my job in viewer services was just like, I so happened to sit next to my first boss, Sakina Irish, who just like sat next, I was cool. Just another thing, be cool, be, you know, just humble and willing to learn and willing to meet people and willing to take the opportunities where they come, because, that was like a meandering path that I took, and it worked out because I kind of just kept going, and a lot of people helped me along the way. Yeah. So many people, along the way were like, helped me when I didn't have the appropriate, you know, the right qualifications, or I wasn't there yet. So we've been talking a lot about that. And now that we're in positions to help people, because so many people helped me. If those people didn't help me along the way, I wouldn't be where I am right now.
Same.
Yes.
Absolutely. So many people who took me under their wing when I wasn't qualified for the job, you know, or I just didn't have the skill set yet.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Or, you know, so I think it's our job to
absolutely to
see things in people, and then you know, do the same. Yeah. So that was my path.
Yeah, Jack, when did
you I mean, I'm different path over here. I guess the thesis of what I'm about to say is what Peter was saying was like, if there's any door cracked open, bum rush that motherfucker. Like, when I was a kid, the only dream I had wasn't to be famous or wasn't to like be a stand-up. It was, I'm gonna write for the Boondocks. That was the only thing I said every single day. It's like, I'm gonna be a person writing for the Boondocks. Now, at the time, the Boondocks was off the air. So I didn't know what that was. So I moved to LA with like, I'm going to remake the Boondocks, and then I'm going to write for Aaron Magruder and give him his job back.
Hell yeah.
And, and it was just this journey of like, I don't know what that means, what that is, but everyone keeps telling me that. I looked up all the writers and all the people that were associated with the show, the voice actors, and a lot of them were involved in stand-up and in improv and in comedy. And so I was like, okay, if that's the way to work for the Boondocks, I'm going to become a stand-up comedian. Had no dreams of being a stand-up comedian. I was like, I'm gonna just do whatever it takes to get in this room and be able to work in Boondocks. Started doing stand-up. I eventually met the Lucas Brothers and Gerard and a lot of Hannibal and all these types of people, and that got me a job at the Lucas Brothers Moving Company. That led me over to the Meltdown Show with Kumail and Emily Gordon, which was where Nick Kroll and Chelsea Peretti saw me, and then that's how I got on Big Mouth. And the same goal was in the back of my head. Like, I'm still going to write for the Boondocks.
That's amazing.
Well, I feel it.
I love that.
Down to everything is about whatever my final goal is, and that final goal for me. Whatever my heart that pumped and the laughs that came from my belly that the Boondocks gave me as a kid, I want to do that for somebody else. Mm-hmm. I want to continue that level of comedy and black fun.
Yes.
At some point in my career. But that takes writing a couple, you know, kitty kitty come come shows like Big Mouth. I'm all for it.
You're doing it too.
That's wild. Both of you, you know, Kerri and Jack, both of you guys, I mean, that all that resonates so much with me, because it was the same with me, like way back before, you know, before I even knew you could get a job in the industry,
right?
Before I knew I could get a job, it was like I had never even thought about it. It was like being an astronaut. But I had decided one day, man, I really think I want to try to be a filmmaker. Mm. You know, couldn't afford to make my own films. Couldn't, you know, knew I wanted to be a director. That led me, like, after stumbling around for a couple of years, to storyboarding. Because I, oh, wait a minute, I can draw good enough to do this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And, oh, my God, people actually get paid for that.
Right.
This is my way in. And it's like it's just like both of you guys said, you educate yourself, you know, read countless books on film technique and writing and all that stuff. Mm-hmm. You know, you educate yourself, you like, you're, you know, humble when opportunities come along or when people open the little door for you or give you that little encouragement. And it's just like this process of like moving at, but never forgetting that goal.
Yep.
You know, and it's just like,
and people
hanging on.
Yeah,
and educating yourself on people. Like, I think a lot of people keep saying educate yourself, education. But the thing that really changed it for me was like, okay, in my head, I thought Aaron Magruder did everything. Then I found out about Rodney Barnes. Yeah. Then I found out about the dudes who made the animation. Then I found out about all these other people who were working there. I was like, wow, let me look at where they came from, how they did that. And now I'm just branch of the branch of the branch of the branch of the tree. And now I know all of black animation.
Frank, I think, do you have anything to add to that?
Yeah, it was great what Kerri mentioned, like just about the help that you receive getting in, like it's because, you know, there's so many people that's taken that time to give you, like I remember when coming out of school and I was like, you know, they talked to us about having to network and all that and being like, you know, the kid who would draw in class and you know, kind of be sheltered away from everyone, kind of observing everything and putting it into something, like I was like, oh damn, we have to like go out and like spark up conversations.
Yeah.
And all this stuff. And but luckily, you know, LinkedIn was pretty new at the time. And so I would reach out. I would just go, okay, animator at this company. And I would just like send blind emails. Mm-hmm. And, I mean, that's how Everett and I met.
That's how we met.
You know, there's so many people that's taking that time. It was like, it wasn't even about just the education alone, because there was so much more that I got from just reaching out and talking to people and getting feedback and having those moments where I could learn more about other people's journeys, because I think there's so many times people kind of think that you wanted to do something and then it just happened and it wasn't like, right. It's like the struggle part is left out. It's like, it was an easy task. And so, and one of the things similar to what Brie mentioned, a couple friends and I, Trent Corey and Bobby Pontias, we started this thing called Rise Up Animation, where people can actually
sign
up and get free feedback from people in the industry, you know, free for all, you know, people.
The sign up for Rise Animation, Rise Up Animation.
You know, that's one of those things I hope that people don't forget when they get, you know, when they get into the industry, is like, don't forget what that struggle was getting into it. Don't forget what you had to do to get in, because there's so many people that, you know, I've been shut down myself. You know, I'm trying to, you know, that ambition that a lot of us have it's easy for that to be shut down, because you think, and maybe it's intimidation. I don't know what it is, but there's a lot of times where I've seen it, not just with me, with other people as well, where, you know, someone's trying to make something of themselves and they're like, hey, wait, no, stay in your position. Like you'll get here when we say you're okay to come up here. And, you know,
it's gross. It makes me think about just, even if you get a late start, right? Because you think that everything feels like it's going to behind the schedule you want for yourself. So for me, even I found myself taking jobs that never fit what I really wanted to do throughout my whole career early on. But I had to switch my brain to realize everything is going to benefit me later on. This job is teaching me this piece about the world. This job is teaching me this piece about the industry. And it's really holding on to those skill sets, because every skill set will make you a better writer, director, executive,
production
person.
Absolutely.
The more you learn from different parts of the industry, even if it's just the way you need to pay your bills today, doesn't mean it's going to be the way you pay your bills tomorrow. Mm-hmm. So I always tell people, don't get caught up on the journey and how long it takes and the struggle it is, because it takes time, but you're not wasting time. You're just you're getting that thick skin. You're getting those skills. You're talking to new friends. You're making new connections. You're going to meet people today that you should be nice to everybody, because you don't know in 20 years, 10 years, that person might be opening that door for somebody. And you just want to remember that you have to work hard. They're going to remember when you worked hard, you're easy to work with, you're fun and you're chill. Mm-hmm. They're going to open that door again for you. So I always think about that when I talk to people, like, just don't give up on that path.
Right.
And my path will probably keep changing. Like, it just depends on what you're looking for, you know? So I always have to keep that inspiration going.
If I may, I think also just a small reminder, it's so easy to just be nice and understanding and warm, and obviously not everyone is extroverted, not everyone is a total introvert, everyone is a nice mix of everything, and, you know, not everyone is openly warm, like on their face or in how they emote, but people don't want to work with assholes. That's not, we're way beyond that, you know? And so it's wild, because, like, whenever you hear stories of asshole directors or asshole leads, it's like, why is no one doing anything? No one wants to be, we're making cartoons, for fuck's sake, people.
Right. Oh my God.
Not that serious. Calm down.
So seriously. All this stuff could be taken away in an instant. And what power are you left with?
Seriously.
That's crazy.
I think that right now, the industry, I'm optimistic. You know, I think that we're here right now having this conversation with each other. And if you asked me 5 years ago, can I get a group of Black people to talk about animation for all to see? I would have a hard time thinking, like, how are they going to do that? where is everybody?
Wouldn't happen.
I think this, even this moment right now, should show everybody that it's possible, and we're here in the animation, and there's other people here too that you're not seeing. There's other people of color, and I think everyone watching should remember there's more room. Like, come join us.
Yes. You can do it.
It's growing, and there's space, and you just got to work hard and bring your best self.
Yeah. It's okay to cry. Listen, if you gotta cry one day because it does get real hard and no one's hitting you up, that's fine. You just also I think, remember, you're good at other things, and I know it's really easy to say I'm not good at anything. This is my life, but there are other things that you may be passionate about you never thought about, like, ever. And so if unfortunately getting into animation or whatever just doesn't work out and it never happens and no one takes a chance, or you're just not good enough, which is also a thing that people should acknowledge, you know, there are other things that you could be fantastic at. So it's not an end all if you don't end up with, you know, your animation heroes, because you can become someone else's hero and something else, you know, the world's
a
the big player.
Yeah. It's healthy to not over identify with what you do. I mean, it's probably sounds a little stupid coming from, you know, some people who've like focused like 40 hours a day.
Totally.
But to, you know, to sort of like realize, you know, at the end of the day, it's one facet of what I am. It may be the biggest one and maybe the one I care about the most, but, you know, there's so much more to life, you know, so. Yeah. Just for your own mental, you know, peace of mind, just remember you're a whole person. You have other things in your life, you know. If a particular job doesn't work out, hey, there's always another one. If a particular career doesn't work out, you can rethink and survive and get past it and get over it. But, you know, take care of yourself as a person. Yeah. And, and the other thing about not working with assholes, you work so hard on these things and you're with people for so long every day. Nobody wants to deal with that.
No, nobody. There's absolutely no place for that. Doesn't matter what position you are or how many amazing movies you've made. If you're a dick, you're a dick. And people remember that. People remember that.
And the days when you can, as we all see now, I think, the days when you could really like skate by on that stuff and get away because you're a genius. That stuff's going away, man.
Yes.
That's like,
absolutely.
You know, people don't, you know they don't have to put up with that anymore.
Right.
And see how toxic entire cultures become because of people like that.
Yeah.
So,
I like that you mentioned like not identifying so hard with something, because there's times where even you have to put it down and come back to it, because you know it's you know, for me, when I was you know, trying to become an animator, like, it was there was a period in college where it just something just wasn't clicking, and I didn't know what it was, and I just it was kind of I had to question myself, like, am I doing the right thing? Is this really what I'm supposed to be doing? You know, I care about it a lot, but is caring about it enough to you know, to make it happen? Or, you know, does that mean that it's for me? And so there was a period where I had to put it down and I was focusing on other stuff and, you know, modeling and stuff, 3D modeling and
I think we all are. You meant modeling?
Don't,
I was like,
you're not beautiful.
What can I draw you? And what are your weights?
You was foot modeling. No. We know.
It is with that blue steel. I want it.
But it was one of those things where, you know, taking that time away, I could kind of recalibrate, and then going back to it, I was like, okay, there was a moment where it hit when a teacher told me something about doing what you're afraid of. And I feel like that was what took me away from it, because it was that fear of like not being good enough to do what I wanted to really do. And so it was like, it was easier to separate it and not, you know, kind of face that. But then going back to it, you know, with the help of other people, getting feedback, getting, you know, just inspiration from people, you know, I was able to come back and start from the beginning and get to where I needed to be. So definitely, like, you know, take time away from it if you need to, if you need to focus on something else, focus on something else. And But I think the bottom, like what Peter was saying earlier about not giving up, like that's a
big that's the core. Part, yeah.
That. You have to fight really those is. Struggles. It's part of it. The struggle is part of it.
Remember what got you into it in the first place. If you, you know,
when
you,
absolutely.
Stay humble. Take a bite of that humble pie when you need it.
Well, you guys, this has been amazing. And I think hearing all of that is very inspirational. We are close to time, but I can hang out with you guys later. Let's just stay on the phone all day.
Do it again.
To your point, like I want to thank you guys seriously for coming together. And also just, this is a conversation was so important, but it doesn't mean it's the last conversation. There's more of these to come. And also what's more important is people have these conversations in their home life, at their work. And it doesn't just have to be Black people talking. It should be our allies talking.
Absolutely.
It should be underrepresented people talking. It's about having these conversations and being more
comfortable.
That's
the world we want.
Yes.
Absolutely.
It's open and it's vulnerable. Thank you guys for doing this. It's been incredible.
Thank you.
Thank you, Stevie.
Thanks for putting it together, Stevie. Yes. You went crazy.
Everyone is for Stevie. Hey. So we're gonna pop some bottles back here, you guys. But thank you everybody for watching. The comment chat was bumping. I couldn't read it. It was too much. Participating. We are gonna sign out soon, and we appreciate you. Thanks for listening to Black Creatives in Animation.
Thank you.
Bye guys.
Bye.
All the love.
Bye.